Interesting place. Why is everything so loud today? I don't know what it is. Everything just sounds so loud in my ears. Let me know if the volume's okay, guys. I don't know if it's a little bit off or something. It should be okay. Just in my ears, it's gone all crazy. All right, let's introduce our players. So kicking things off for is in the to the bottom left side of the map is going to be our pink Protoss player. It's going to be Kerr. And then the upper right side of the map, it'll be our blue Protoss player from True Esports is Garikra. So, both players going to open with the two-gate opening here on Ruins of Syrass and just look to get some early pressure onto the map, some early map control with some early Stalkers or Adepts, whatever they decide, before they go in towards those expansions. We might even see them being super aggressive with some kind of tech play before they expand as well. So we'll see what happens here in the early stages, but not going to be super fast expansions, as we do see the first probe of the game coming out from Kerr. Going to be going to scout around, and we'll soon identify that this is cross positions. This probably means he's looking to send some adepts out on the map to pressure, whereas Grigrail probably not looking to do that, because, I mean, if he doesn't know where his opponent is, how is he possibly going to send units out to be able to harass and attack around the map? Oh no, you know, attack into his opponent's base, you know. So we do see Kerr just going to be seeing his opponent not in the top left, as we see the gateways do finish up. Well, the gateways have been finished for a while, but the Cybernetics Core has now finished up. We're going to see Warp Gate starting to be kind of boosted out here, and a Cybernetics Core on the, a Mothership Core on the way for Grigrail alongside Stalkers. So both players going into Stalkers here early, Grigrail going into that one extra the Mothership Core, whereas we just see extra probes coming in from Kerr, who is passing that optimal saturation now, so probably is getting to that point where he wants to drop Mothership Core, unless he wants to spend his money on something aggressive, such as a Stargate, or, you know, I mean, pretty much any kind of tech, because we do see Kerr actually comes up here. He goes kind of over towards the ramp, but not up the ramp, and it's almost as though he just says, you know what, I want to keep this probe alive, more so than kind of, you know, pushing in and seeing what you've got. I mean, I can see you haven't expanded, I can see you're in this base. That's all the information I really need right now, and he's just going to keep this out here, as we do see a probe scouting around for Grigrail as well, looking to see what he might be able to get up to here in the near future. These couple of Stalkers from Kerr about to pop out. Mothership Core on the way up, and it is a Twilight Council that's being placed for him in the back of his mineral line. The first deck of the game for Grigrail is also on the way up, as we're going to see these Stalkers going to have to back away from this situation. The tech from Grigrail is going to be that robo facility in the back of the main base, as we see these couple of Stalkers being pushed back, being pushed away from now. Pylon has come up over here, as we do have a couple of possibilities. Either we see Dark Templar warping in off of the Twilight Council, Dark Shrine, or we see just a Blink play with this kind of heavy Stalker count we've seen being set up so far. And Kerr is going to start dropping that Blink with a third gate as well. He's probably going to look to add on a fourth gateway over here for faster warp bins, and will just be looking for a lot of aggression in the very early stages of this game. Now, from Grigrail's point of view, he's initially going to just corner boost out an Immortal, so not afraid of DTs or anything just yet, or want to know what his opponent is up to. Just once again, Immortal out, make sure he's got enough to be able to defend against the first wave of aggression from his opponent. He's also going to drop a Twilight Council of his own now, and so the problem is, I mean, Grigrail is going to have a good army, definitely a standing army which can fight against the army of his opponent, but the question is he going to be able to deal with the mobility of his opponent's army? These Stalkers from Kerr have a lot of different places where they can jump into, where they can look to get damaged. So if they hop into the main base over here, for example, they can get a pylon or two. I mean, I say that though. I was going to say they can get a pylon or two, maybe some workers, but then again, there's that Mothership Core ready to float an overcharge, so maybe they can't. And I mean, that's what it comes down to. Is the defense from Grigrail going to be good enough? As he probably will be looking to expand here very shortly. Well, Kerr is going to be putting pretty much everything into this aggression, currently warping in off of the slow pylon right now. His gateway is building up over here, and his blink is about 30 seconds, 40 seconds until completion, but it has got Corona Boost on it, so it will be sped up ever so slightly as these Stalkers continue to come across the map, getting ready to go and attack up into Grigrail right now. He's only just now put down the expansion, so really a very safe expansion from him. I mean, he's actually got a probe down here, so he's actually seen... he actually knows that his opponent hasn't got an expansion either, which is probably why he's been so safe about this, more so than anything else. Now he comes into scout, and we'll see absolutely everything. See that three gateways, he'll see the blink, or Twilight Council being corona boosted, as we do see the first push in from Kerr, as he starts to try and trade towards the front. He has actually popped the barrier off of that mortal. Double phone overcharge is going to go down here at the front. Oh, no, actually, Grigrail leaving that barrier cast on, taking it off autocast, basically. And so you could use it at the very end there to keep that Immortal alive. So That now will be on cooldown though. Two photon overcharges have been popped to number two, ready to go. As you're going to see the Stalker starting to blink back. But I mean, with the Immortal here to help micro, to help deal the damage, even a very good micro occur is not able to really get anything done here. He's not able to pick that Immortal off because it's just too far away, shooting from the back. As we see these Stalkers going to be pushing forwards and looking to see if they can get up this ramp, get any further damage done. One last photon overcharge comes down. And they are starting to take quite a lead in terms of the Stalker count, but again, it's the fact that he's fighting against his pylon, which has done so much damage. Blink is about to come up for Grickrail as well, and that's going to be a major advantage that was here for Kerr previously, and it's just going to rip it away from him. A second Immortal now out as well. The barrier is back up on the first Immortal, so this really should be an army, which I don't think can really be broken, as we are going to see the Blink micro coming in. There's no pylons to help out this time, but you can see Kerr just realizes that this is not happening, backs away. I'm just going to have to be a little bit more cautious. We have a few Stalkers, a couple of Immortals up on the high ground. Another Stalker being warped in over here. As we have that Blink finishing up now for Grickrail. And again, this is where the game becomes a lot easier for him. Because now he can micro his own Stalkers back. He can keep his own Stalkers alive during all of this incoming pressure and aggression. As these Zealots, these Stalkers starting to come up this ramp. But again, a phone overcharge ready to go. And so Grickrail can continue to defend. And I'm just so surprised that Kerr hasn't even once tried to go over towards the main base. I mean, he doesn't have anything for high ground vision apart from the Mothership Core, which is on the wrong side of the map. I'm surprised he hasn't just tried one single time to get up on the right-hand side, go into the main, especially when he's got the Mothership Core over here. I mean, okay, there is an observer in position for Verdi, and so he can see where this army moves, so he should be able to respond in time, but it's at least worth trying, you know? He's done nothing else other than to try brute forcing his way up this ramp. Now we see a third Immortal being produced. We see plenty of Stalkers from Verdi, and he's also got that worker lead, so he's going to be continuing to pull ahead in terms of army supply here, as that economic advantage really does kick in. So we're going to see some Zealots and Sentries starting to lead the charge here. Going to force field those Immortals away, but they are still in range, but only of the Zealots, so not the most efficient of Immortal shots, but that photon overcharge coming down once more, and again, Kerr cannot make this happen. As he's going to try and warp in a few more Zealots. He did have a Dark Shrine just finishing. No, he actually doesn't. It was actually just a pilot, my bad. Metagamed myself, as types out GG. Introduce our players. Coming in as the next player from is Imber to try and pull them back into this series. To the bottom left side of the map, it's our Red Terran player. It is Avocado. Swedish player, I remember in the first seasons of the SCTRTL, he played for Team Darkstar. That was a long time ago now. it was a real long time ago now, over 2 years ago. 2.5 years nearly. But, yes, Avocado was a very strong player for Darkstar back then, and, well, I don't think he's actually won a map yet so far this season for his Imber. Of course, the opponents have been a lot tougher than what Darkstar play faced back in the first season or two. To the upper right from True Esports, it is going to be Grickrail, aka Rail, aka Verdi. And he is up here in the upper right side of the map. Couple of gates coming down, it's going to be a two gate based opening from Verdi, who has also gone into double gas as well. I'm starting to scan across the map to see what is going on as well. Also, he's going to find himself in cross spawns here with his opponent, which is, well, good if you don't want super crazy games. I mean, the horizontal spawns are so good for Terran to drop from their main into your own main that air distance is pretty darn short. As I see, Verdi comes in, confirms there's no Terran player up here. And he's going to turn around and those cross spawns now. And as he comes down to this bottom left side, he will find a command center building off the back of a Reaper expansion. So, Reaper expansion coming in from Avocado. Nothing wacky, crazy too early on in this game. As this Reaper's about to pop out, and will go and start scouting for himself. Will immediately go towards the bottom right, as you would expect, just to try and see. And, you see this probe actually pokes in and sees the expansion. That's all he really wants to see for now. And will actually just look to pull back with this probe and keep it alive. And maybe we see a Stargate or something coming in up here. For now, we are going to see two Stalkers and the Mothership Core on the way out. So he is going to get very aggressive here. He might just use that probe to build some pylons. And I'm at the front, you know, maybe just a pylon here to try and take down these depots. Definitely a possibility. No, it is going to be a pylon to the top left, though. So he is probably just looking to put down a a Stargate in the near future, as we are going to see Stalker is going to, two Stalkers going to be able to come in and start working away against that Reaper. Do actually get a kill on it as well, so no Reaper scouting really for Avocado in this game. But he does scout the lack of a natural Nexus, and the lack of a natural Nexus and seeing Stalkers too, he knows now that this is going to be some pretty committed aggression in the very early stages of this game. As we're going to see this SCV, we'll just kind of come out. We'll actually see that Mothership Core and see these two Stalkers. So he knows this is committed now, in case he didn't figure it out before. That being said, though, he's just going to be able to lift it and pull it away from his natural. He's got a bunker on the front of his wall, and that will help a lot in terms of defending in the early stages of this. Stargate on the way up as well from Verdi, and that's what we're really going to be looking towards, trying to see him getting some more damage done. A pylon going to come up the front too, which will help him to try and keep this, try and keep these depots alive, to try and take down these depots. We're actually going to see SCVs pulled to try and take this down. Marine's coming out of the bunker to try and help out as well. And looks like the first pylon will go down. And this kind of puts us in a very interesting scenario, maybe not your standard expectations of the kind of the pylon rush, which we see quite a lot. He is going to get a depot here, another bunker going to come into the right, as this Marauder in this bunker is helping out a lot. And that photon overcharge in the back is not going to reach this. I actually thought he was going to keep that pylon just to stop stop Avocado from ever moving out of his base. As you see the Stalkers thinking of moving forwards, but have to be so careful. There's so many Marines also to the right-hand side, as a couple of depots are lost. But, I mean, of course, the natural expansion is so late for Verdi here. Now, that is okay for now, as we're going to see this Oracle popping out of the Stargate. And, again, it's proxied, so it should get across here pretty quick. But he's not actually going to move it across just yet. He's going to wait for seconds Oracle. And just say to his opponent, you know, if you're expecting an Oracle, it's probably going to come in maybe about now. And so by the time it actually does come in, maybe you're not going to be expecting it anymore. As we do see that Mothership Core falls, that means that once this Photon Overcharge disappears, these units should be able to push their way out of this natural expansion and to start, or start out of the main base and towards the natural expansion. Just the Photon Overcharge makes it a little bit too much DPS to really attack into just yet. The couple of Marauders which have been added on as well, helping out a lot, and especially against the Stalkers, that little bit of extra range stops them from just being able to kite Marines for days and days and days. So that Pavon will go down. Verdi, again, expanded behind this, has a 7 worker lead, but only Robo Facility down in terms of tech. As we see them two Oracles starting to come in, and this is what's really going to hurt Avocado here, who's just not forward about the possibility of a Stargate follow-up behind this at all, and two Oracles just going to kill SCV so quickly. I mean, one Oracle would have done a lot of damage in this scenario, but two Oracles are just going to do, well, uncountable amount of damage. I mean, it is countable, because we see 12, 13, 14 workers going down, but I mean, 14 workers killed, and the Oracles stay alive too. And sort of a dream scenario here for our Protoss player. Also sees the timing of the factory finishing, and he's up on 33 probes against 12 SCVs. Grickrail looking as though he is going to be heading into game number 3 of this series with a 2-0 lead for his team off the back of two fairly quick games so far. I mean, this game's not over yet, but it more or less may be, as we see 3 more workers going down. Avocado down to now just 11 workers. 2 more about to pop out, sure, but not looking good for him. As these couple of Oracles is going to be sitting up on top of this natural, sitting just above it. I was going to see a Marine stimming out towards the middle of the map. Some Stalkers and Adepts and an Immortal from Grickrail just going to be coming out of the natural here. And we'll actually run into a little bit of that army at the back. I was going to see Warpers on the way out as well for Verdi. Looking to, well, perhaps just continue, you know, reinforce his attack a bit. I mean, he's killed so many workers. He doesn't actually have much of an army lead just yet. I don't think he's got enough to kind of break defender's advantage, but I guess a lot of these units are kind of heavily damaged already from earlier in the game, so maybe he can just push up here and end this game. He's got a couple Oracles still as well, so I mean, there's not even that many Marines. We see these Adepts already shading forwards. Will he decide to attack in? It looks as though he wants to. Already these units are pulling back. There's, well, actually there's no medevacs just yet. They're still just building. As we see the Oracles back in the way, the Adepts will start fighting against this. The Oracles kind of need to be a part of this, you know. I think the Oracles are kind of DPS which he really needed to add on to this, or kind of damage that needed to be soaked up, because the Immortal is pulling back. And, well, yeah, I think there's going to be a hold. I think he could maybe just about tail this away and probably will force it to go back home. But again, I mean, the problem is he lost another 6 workers and he just can't keep up with his production compared to his opponent. He's on 44 workers, 2 bases, and very happily mining with 2 fully saturated mineral lines. With a Robo Bay up, Colossus Tech going to be on the way as Extended Thermal Lance has started. The Forge is on the way at the natural now as well, and Twilight Council too. So the tech continues to roll on in from Verdi here, as we see Avocado just, well, even just pulling away his natural expansion, realizing he doesn't even have enough workers to really mine from that efficiently right now. So why even bother having it out there? It just makes it even harder for him to defend. And seeing this, Grickrail just going to back off for now, realizing there's no point attacking up if his opponent doesn't even have a natural. So he just says, cool, well, I'm just going to move back home and get further and further ahead while you sit back on one base for a little while until you feel safe enough to move out. And that'll just kill you at a later point as I go into Colossi, my plus one, my blink. Maybe we do just see him attack with two or three Colossus with the plus one blink finishing at the same time as well. Something like that is definitely a pretty big possibility here. Surprised we haven't actually seen him just try to drop a third base, because there's not really been anything on the map to stop him from taking a third base, so he definitely could have got away with it. He's just starting to get to that point in the game where he's a little bit oversaturated. I mean, his main base, his first set of minerals in the main base have mined out, so he's got 8 workers oversaturating on the, or kind of past the optimal efficiency on the natural. As you're going to see, very small force from Avocado is starting to move across the map. I mean, these are Marines which don't even have combat shields yet 9 minutes into this game, despite the fact there's a very quick 3 racks opening. A couple of Widow Mines mixed in too, but how can you ever really imagine these doing too much damage? We're going to see Adepts also dropping over here, getting some good damage done. Liberator picks off 4 workers, but it means 4 workers for 4 workers, and so Avocado forces this away, but he's kind of coming out in a even trade, which is not what he needs right now. He needs more than even trades. He needs better than even trades. We are going to see Marines stem in towards the main, and this could be a lot of damage, and this is the sort of thing which could definitely pull him right back into this. He's going to kill the Mothership 4 very quickly, as he does just pull away from the Pirate 4 and overcharges. He'll kill off 5, 6. It's only been 6 workers so far. That's crazy. I thought it was way more. As the Colossi come in, they will help to force this back. Well, 6 workers killed. It's better than nothing. This Liberator's been obviously helping out over time as well. War Prism's still a threat down to the south side of the map. And Avocado does start to put himself back into this just a little bit. I mean, 9 worker disadvantage isn't so bad. It's just the fact he's also on half the army supply of his opponent. As he loses out on a Marine left towards the front here. This Widow Mine picked off some unit which was transferring between the bases. And might be able to get another kill here in a couple of moments' time if Grickrill has not actually noticed it. But he has got an observer on the way out, and he is rallying it into position. So it looks as though he knows about that Widow Mine, and it will be cleaned up before any further damage is found. So Widow Mine goes down, and again Avocado back at home is now kind of lost his aggression and momentum on the map. He is going to send out another couple of medevacs towards the top side. As we see, this War Prism looking to get back in towards the the main base. Just bypasses that Widow Mine at the corner of the main base here. As you're going to see already 2 workers going down. That's going to be a third. As we will see, the Widow Mine now goes off on the War Prism, but doesn't kill it completely. Just gets it a little bit lower on health, so that's a little bit easier to snipe off later on here. As we'll see, these medevacs unloading, and again, the drop play is something that Avocado obviously was relying on here to try and pull himself back into this. But in this situation, he just loses a bunch of units, and Freddy is. I don't know actually. I mean, it's one of these scenarios where he is pretty far ahead, and whatever Avocado is doing is just not really working. It's, you know, he's throwing drops at his opponent, he's trying to just sit back and defend at the same time, but he's not finding a way back into this game. Is that War Prism still sitting down to the south side? We see, I mean, I'm still surprised Verdi hasn't even tried to take a third base. Obviously very confident in his ability to just kill his opponent here with kind of a push off 2 bases without needing that third base, despite his main base getting very close to mine down. I mean, we're talking about 800 minerals or so left, 1,000 at most. The thing is, I think it's 800 or so left in this main, and so we really are getting to this point where Verdi is running out of, he's running out of resources, and eventually Avocado will reach the same state. Now, resources lost is massively favoring Verdi, so that's okay for him. As long as it stays, even if he just trades perfectly evenly now, he will eventually just have more than his opponent if they both just mine out on 2 bases. But you're surprised to see Verdi hasn't even tried to take a third base, I guess because, again, he doesn't really think he needs to. Because he has Phoenix going to come in and help to buffer up this army. They'll come in and obviously be able to either tank the Vikings a bit, kill off the Vikings. Some Marines and Marauder running on through here, and it looks as though the Vikings gonna pull back alongside these medevacs. The small amount of bio, there's just no bio at all. It's like, what, like there's actually only 10 Marines and 6 Marauders, which is not gonna be enough DPS. We're gonna see the Vikings will just get taken down by the Phoenix, and that will be GG. Verdi takes gate number 2. The gold instead of one of the outer bases, so let's introduce our players. To the bottom right, we'll have our blue Zerg player from Is Imber. Is it going to be done? He's coming in to try and take a map here against True Esports. Donna, one of these players who actually came in the other day for Is Imber and all killed against EC Visualize. Very impressive and just solid, you know, straight up solid performance from him there. Nothing really, you know, it was one of them matches where he just looked like the better player in every single game, and There's a couple of times where he maybe looked a little bit shaky, but he, you know, he looked a little bit shaky into all of a sudden he was just completely fine and winning the game. So he really did crush through his EC Visualize the other day, which was a big win for his Ember in terms of moving up in towards the middle of the rankings rather than staying down in the bottom side of the table. The other left side of the map, we do see the Red Protoss player from True Esports. Already has one all kill this season, is halfway to his second. He is our Red Protoss player. It is Verdi. He came out and he all killed Nuit Blanche, who sent out Johnny Rico as their first player back then, took down, I believe, Beastie Cutie and Azurg. Yeah, Beastie Cutie and Guru, I think it was. Then Verdi came out and he put a stop to it, basically. So he put a stop to Johnny Rico and he won 3 more after that, took his first all kill of the season. And again, now on his way to another one. In fact, he might actually just be already, only 4-0 this season. I think it's... Did he play against Liquid as well? He did play against Liquid. He lost to Bunny. So I think Verdi's 4-1 this season. For all kill here today would be 8-1, which would be pretty good for him. It would be pretty good going, as we have some probes just transferring down to the low ground Nexus. Nothing really too extraordinary going on. It was 3 hatch before pool from our Zerg player. As we see, the 3rd hatch about to finish, and the Queen's just now starting up, so... Very, very standard stuff here as they're playing greedily and getting away with it for now. Our Protoss player has been scouting around on the map though and has seen how late this Gassen pool was, and that's enough for him to know that there is a third base up, doesn't really need to see anything else as we have seen. It was a big of a greedy opening from Grigrail as well. I mean, we see the double gateway down at the front, and that's because it was a Nexus first initially. So Nexus first against 3 hatch before pool, both players just looking for the greed, although of course it will slightly favour our Zerg player a bit more because he has access to that extra set of gold minerals from a very early stage of the game. I'm actually surprised he's got full saturation here. I guess he's just going to make the rest of his drones and rally them over here. I'm surprised he didn't just saturate it immediately with these drones. Then again, you do lose mining time as you transfer them, so not as worthwhile as it is to saturate your natural immediately. And he will get that saturated pretty quickly as we see Stargate play going to be coming out of Grickwill. That Stargate coming down the back of the main, and of course a tech tree, which we've seen a lot recently in the PvZ matchup. It does so many things. First of all, Phoenixes are just so good. The Oracle can come in and be very useful as well in terms of defending against kind of mass link plays early in the game, and just harassing too. But the Phoenix is what we've really seen be so useful. I mean, Zerg's kind of pigeonholed. If you go Phoenix, your Zerg is basically pigeonholed into Hydras. But the problem is, if the Zerg builds Hydras, then you just still, you know, your Phoenix can actually do a really good job of slowing down the Hydra tech, picking off Hydras as they start to pop out. It just puts you into a very, very good position. So see a couple more gates being built. It's going to be an Oracle to start things off. We'll see if Verdi wants to go into Phoenix after this, or if it is just going to be the Oracle. I mean, even with the Stargate on the map, it is just something that says, you know, you shouldn't go, you know, it just says to the Zerg player, don't go Mutalisks. Because if you go Mutas, I've got the Stargate up, I can very quickly build Phoenix against those if I need to. As the first Oracle comes out, and it is just going to be Phoenix follow-up as well. And I mean, why not? It's actually, you know, I actually kind of feel like this Phoenix opening has been so used so much lately, has been so good. We might even see a change in the near future because it really has been. I don't know. I just feel as though if an opening is, it's not necessarily broken. It's just, it's so much better than any other Protoss opening that I think we need to see something to make it a little bit, you know, a little bit better, you know, as we see Nine Workers killed from this first Oracle. And I mean, Nine Workers killed already, and he's going to go Phoenix. Wow, this is not the best of starts here for Darna. And just missing a Spore Crawl on each of his mineral lines. He had that Spine, but not the Spore. Just wasn't quite prepared for that initial Oracle coming in and getting the damage done, which it achieved just there. You can see a couple more Adepts being added on. Down on this third base. There's going to be quite a lot of Adepts coming across. So it's going to be Resonating Glaives too. The third from Verdi just going to be put down, not at the goal, but just in the forward position here. You see a lot of Lings coming across the map, but there's so many Adepts, these Lings cannot realistically look to attack into that at all. And we'll see. I mean, what basically what Verdi is hoping to achieve here is he's hoping to attack across the map. He's going to use the Phoenix to lift anything that's going to be a major threat to the Adepts, which is basically Roaches and Queens. And then anything else, he's just going to be able to kill with the Adepts, you know, Zerglings. Hydras also died very quickly to Adepts, especially when that Resonating Glaives is finished, and it is two-thirds of the way done right now. 4 Phoenix out, starting to move across the map. There's Oracle here as well, will help against, well, I mean, it helps against Hydras a little bit, helps against Zerglings. Of course, Hydras will be able to pick it off. It's still kind of nice. We see I think I saw a couple of Hydras being made. Nope, actually, maybe cancelled them. We have seen lots of Roaches coming out here to try and deny this Adept play. Zergans are over to the left-hand side of the map. It may just try and come in and attack this Vid, but Photon Overcharges are available, and so shouldn't really be able to achieve too much, as the Adept's never really committed on this side of the map either, and they're just heading back home. So Vid are going to look for his next stage of the game here, which is going to be a Robo facility initially. Now, War Prison would be very nice to start getting some of these Adepts out on the map and harassing. I mean, maybe peel some over to the right-hand side and then drop some into the main base, because Adepts are, you know, Adepts are okay, but they're one of these units that you don't want them in mass in your late game army, I don't think. In PvZ, you generally want Immortal, Archon, and Zealot. And I mean, Adepts are okay, but it probably gets to a point where you want to start, you know, if you can trade them effectively for workers and economy damage, then you're probably going to be happier than having them actually as part of your army, because against Roaches, they really don't do a lot. I mean, if they completely outnumber the Roaches, they will kill Roaches very quickly. But they shouldn't really ever get a chance to fight against anything other than Roaches, maybe some Zerglings in the front. But they will never kind of reach the Hydras, which is what you really want to get rid of here in the PvZ matchup when it gets into the later stages of the game. We're going to see some Phoenix moving over to the left. Just having a think about what they want to get up to. Fourth base is going to start coming down as well. We're going to see these Phoenix coming in, and we're going to see one going down to a Spore Crawler, just looking to continue harassing here. While back at home, Robo Base about to finish up from Verdi. We'll also see a Forge coming down too, so looking to head into his upgrades at the Hydra count. Getting to this point now where the Phoenix, as long as the Hydras are there, Phoenix can't really team up and pick too much off, although they can keep poking around, of course, and look for the openings where the Hydras are not. Like, right now, they're back out towards the front, and there's actually very little creep spread connecting these bases, which means the Hydras are very slow to come back into the main base and to respond against this as that Queen gets lifted. And you can see Queen going down, and Drone going down here to the left side as well, Hydra too. And yeah, so Phoenix continue to do harassment here, and we can see it's been a very effective set of Phoenix harassment, really. One Phoenix lost for 15 drones, two Hydras. I mean, 15 drones, a lot of them came from the initial Oracle, don't forget, is, oh no, that first Disruptor shot does a lot of damage. 7 kills on this, does miss with the second one, but these Stasis Wards are doing a lot of damage too. Not necessarily damage, but taking a lot of these units out of the equation. So many Zergans just taken out of the fight before the fight even begins. Now they are about to come back into the fight, but they're going to come back into the fight when a lot of the Roaches are already gone, and these Hydras are already wanting to try and retreat back home. And we are going to see the Adepts start pulling back a little bit, and we are going to see another Disruptor hitting the Hydras here. More Hydras going down, as we will see. There he is, looking as though he's going to hold on, more or less. He's lost a lot, though. He's lost all of his Disruptors. He's lost his Phoenix, too. His attack was not a complete disaster from Darna, but he does end up behind. So it wasn't a complete disaster, but it wasn't brilliant for him either. I mean, he killed a lot of the heavy, you know, the tech-heavy units. He got rid of the Phoenix, and he got rid of the Disruptors. If it wasn't for that, it would have been a disaster. But as it stands right here, it's been okay for him. But still behind, definitely, as his fourth base has come up, but he's kind of trailing in workers even. His gold base is, of course, mining out because they mine out a lot faster than regular base, just because you mine more from them, and yet they have the same number of minerals. Which is a bit of a shame, as an Oracle does get blown up there. It's blown away and gets thrown up to the upper side. And blown to pieces. Temple Archives on the way down from Verdi, who will just be looking to set himself up into a position where he can stabilize a little bit. Temple Archives go and finish up. We're going to see the plus one weapons is going to finish up for him shortly too, so he's going to equalize the upgrades here in this game. So this kind of looks, you know, it gets better and better for Verdi, whereas we see Darna's basically going for the exact same composition he had in that last engagement, but now he's not going to have an upgrade lead. Now there's going to be more Immortals and Archons and so on out for Verdi as well. And so you've got to look at this and say, well, what is, you know, what's the plan for Darna here? You know, what is his next stage of the game for him? Doesn't have a Lurker Den, doesn't have an Infestation Pit, so he can't stop going into Hive. There's really very little he has, which is, you know, makes this look brilliant for him. These Immortals are just so, so good. And what I love as well is that Verdi is not even being greedy. He just takes the fourth base up on the high ground, which is very easy to defend relative to this, when compared to this gold base to the left. So I like this. He's even making sure he doesn't have to stretch himself out too thin, and that, you know, he's basically not allowing his opponent to even stretch him out too thin. and just, you know, out harass him in towards the later stages of this game. We're going to see Urochida wants to come in and trade with this. And we are going to see the Immortals turn around every now and then, getting some shots off onto these Roaches. And these Roaches actually taking a lot of damage. Them Immortals doing so much here. As Archon's in the front, also going to add a little bit of splash onto this. A Ravager shot, well, catches an Immortal and a Zealot at the back, as we'll see Verdi continuing to move on through. There's a lot of Hydras, and that's a lot of DPS in this army for Darna. Is it going to be enough, though, as the Archons are still pushing on through? He's starting to run out of Roaches, but there's still a good chunk of Hydras left. It's just, you look at this, you think, well, maybe the Zerg's doing it, and then you realize that Immortals just don't die, and he keeps on killing off everything else, and then the Zerg's got no option other than to just... Well, I just haven't realized, so... we've seen a lot more PvPs lately than we've seen in a long time here in the Team League, so... It's been interesting, been kind of cool to see the PvPs play out and see the sort of builds. PvP was a matchup I didn't see for ages at the start of Legacy of the Void, and it was a matchup I really was myself very lost in when it came to kind of understand what was going on and what might happen and what players are likely to do, because we just didn't see very much of it, and it was kind of weird. And then obviously it turned into kind of Stalker Disruptor Ball for a while. Now it's in a bit of a different place as we introduce our players to the top right side of the map. From Is Imba, it'll be our orange Protoss player, it will be Monty. And his opponent down to the bottom left from True Esports, on the verge of his second all kill of the season, it is going to be Verdi. Okay, Grishrael. I really don't like, I should just call him Rail because I really can't do the first half of his name here in any kind of flattering way. As we see, the opening is going to be a second gateway coming down from Monty as he walls off towards the front to try and deny any information being gained. And it's going to be the same from... Verdi is doing this. It's going to be a double gate opening from both players, and both of them going to wall off here early on just to deny the early scouting of their opponent. So this makes it very difficult to see whether your opponent's going to be expanding behind this. I mean, I kind of like it how... I mean, what Monty's done is basically saying, well, I'm not going to expand, right? Because, or not early anyways, because I've got two gateways. Whereas if he scouted Verdi, he would only see one gate, and then he doesn't know if it's an expansion over here, or if there's a second gate. You know, he doesn't really know what it is, so... You know, see this probe just continue to tackle down this pylon. We do see a proxy stargate coming in from Monty down to this south side, which is kind of, I mean, what you want to kind of hide and just stop your opponent from finding out about. This probe is eventually going to turn away, and he's just going to back off right now. Guys, what's up in the chat, by the way? How are you all doing? I haven't really asked you guys and said much to you all today. It's been a little bit quiet in here, so... Let me know what's up. Let me know how you're doing. Hope you're all having a good start to your week. And it's going to be a busy week, busy few weeks for us here at SCT Improve. We have, of course, tomorrow the Gopher SCT Monthly Finals. We've got Team League Wednesday, Thursday, and Saturday. And we also have Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, the Do You Star Series, the new online cup for Chinese and Korean players. So that'll be through the midday CET is the starting time for that on Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. So busy, busy week here, and we'll finish the week with Gopher SCT2 and the ESL Americas Open as always. So, a very busy week for us, and then it continues with the UK and Ireland 2016 Series Spring Qualifier next Monday, a week today. Something which we just announced today, which you can check out on the website, sct2improve.net. However, we've got to talk about this because this proxy Oracle play is about to get completely shut down. There's already a Phoenix out, which means the Oracle has no choice other than to just suicide in, because it will just die eventually. Yeah, I mean, 1-2 kills, completely denied. I mean, this proxy stargate has done absolutely nothing for Monty, and I'd be very surprised if he actually decided to... kind of let this Oracle finish. I guess if he can kind of hide it a bit and go around the other way and come in at a later point when the Phoenix are across the map, it might be one of them things where you just don't expect to see a second Oracle, so Verdi never goes looking for it, doesn't prepare for it. As we're going to see the Oracle coming over to the left-hand side. The Phoenix is coming over here, having a bit of a nibble on that mothership core. Both players have expanded behind this, so Monty actually holds a single worker lead. It's just the fact that he will fall behind a little bit because these Phoenix are going to end up doing a bit of damage almost guaranteed at some point. Whereas his composition, you know, he doesn't guarantee him any damage at all, but he is going into Blink, Verdi going into Immortals. As we are going to now see him, you know, this is what I'm talking about. He does find a way to guarantee himself a few worker kills, so he gets a few here, 4, 5. 5 more for an Oracle, it's like, is 5 really worth? I mean, 5 is usually very good for an Oracle if you keep it alive, but, I don't know, if you lose the Oracle, I don't think 5 is that worthwhile. But obviously he made that oracle with the intention of just diving and suiciding it, and I mean, maybe not. I mean, maybe he had the idea to pull it back and to keep it, you know, and to keep it away from the Phoenix. But, I mean, once it's revealed, Verdi knows it's on the map. He's going to be hunting for that, and it's very likely it will just end up going down as these two Phoenix do come across. Verdi actually stopped producing Phoenix at just 2, so he actually isn't going to have that much potential to do further damage in this game, as one of these things takes quite a lot of damage with Blink on the way up. That would have been a guaranteed kill in a couple of minutes' time when that Blink is here. Has these couple of Phoenix just going to be backing away now. The natural expansion, again, up for both players, but Verdi not going to be stopping just that natural. No, he's going to go straight into a third base. Very confident, very comfortable with his position in this game. And actually going to even squeeze out his Void Ray from the Stargate, which is, I mean, the Mortal Void Ray is basically saying Void Rays don't really transition well to the later stages of the game, I don't feel. They're very easily countered. But to go Immortal Void Ray basically says, I want to build up a very strong army right now. And, you know, bypass upgrades, bypass, you know, the longevity, you know, bypass the kind of fact that I could have an army that survives for longer and just really try and either kill you soon or just defend here early on and then transition a little bit slower, so just making sure that you're safe. As we see the Stalker's just going to be moving around. Monty going to be coming down and having a, again, look to see what is up and what is happening. This probe going to be popping a pylon down. Will be getting ready to take his third base, but so much later than his opponents. And this is the thing with the couple of Phoenix on the map. I mean, they don't do a lot, but they do get scouring. So they knew, you know, they were poking around. It keeps his opponent back home, and it gives him a lot of freedom to just put his own third down. And of course, it's something which Monty doesn't know about. He doesn't know how early this third is. And now it's too late for him to do anything about it, because there's a couple of pylons coming up at the front. There's a photon overcharge available. And now there's 3 Immortals and Battleby 2 Void Rays. These Stalkers are not going to achieve very much at all. Rolf, Stefan in the chat, where have I been? I missed your casts. I've not really been anywhere, man. Like, Rudy really didn't cast during IEM Katowice. We've been casting the majority of the last few days. We've been doing Go for SC2, we've been having some Team League action. We've been around all week. We really have, so we only took a couple of days off for Katowice, that's about it. We've been pretty consistent otherwise. As we do see, well, he tried to do something across the map with these Stalkers, but already got pushed away once. He's going to try and come up here once again. Might get himself a pylon this time around, which is nice. The photon overcharge was popped in that, so takes a little bit of damage, but kills the pylon. It's something. He's working there. He's working on this. He's getting somewhere as his third base starts to come up, but I mean, well, the Dark Shrine could be interesting. Does he have a Warp Prism? No. The problem is, the supplies are down for Monty. And not only, okay, he does have a Warp Prism, sorry. Of course he does. The supplies are down for Monty, and not only are the supplies down, but his tech is down. You know, you look at this army, he's got a bunch of Blink Stalkers against now 5 Immortals, 3 Void Rays. How do you ever expect to win this? I mean, Blink Stalkers can be very good on mass in certain scenarios, but on Dusk Towers, there's not even the opportunity to try and set up a base trading sort of situation, you know, 9 times out of 10, because how do the armies bypass each other when there's only one attack path on the map for ground armies to move through? It's very, very difficult, so I'm not really sure where Monty goes from here. He's not in a good position at all. He's going to see a Warp Prism coming in and start dropping in the natural. I mean, this is the sort of thing which might bring him right back into this game. 4 DTs dropping in over here, and he's just going to start going straight to town on these workers. And he gets 6 immediately. He needs to get some more, man. He really needs more than just 6 workers here, as he comes into the main base now as well. Just splitting up the DTs a little bit. There's only actually one observer out so far, so that's kind of nice. He actually ends up with 13 work kills at the CT in the natural, at the third base. Sorry, he's actually getting a lot done. 16 work kills, so actually, this is the sort of thing that can pull Monty right back into this game. If he kills all these workers, 20 workers now, and 21, it's going to be 22, 23 before this DT actually dies. I mean, this much damage, 22 workers killed. Now all he has to do is survive a little while longer, and he should be able to build up an army to contest with his worker lead. Although, that being said, maybe Verdi just has enough of an advantage already that he can kind of just, you know, even if he has his opponent has to kind of build up and get ready to go again, he can maybe just sit back and, yeah, I don't know. It's tough. It really, really is. We're going to see these Stalkers continuing to back away here. Monty just pulling back, and we're going to see another Stalker being picked off. I mean, this is exactly what Verdi needs to do, right? I mean, He took a lot of economic damage, but he still has a very solid army advantage. And again, the supplies are starting to even up. Monty has plus one. But you look at the actual units, you see four voids and six immortals to, you know, what tech at all? You know, pretty much nothing. There's even some Phoenix in this too, which are always going to be eligible to kind of come in, pick up an immortal and take that out of the equation for a little while. Verdi not going to commit, just pulling back home. And he's just going to go into a fleet beacon as he continues to have a void raise as well. So again, really just looking to have this army just, you know, really full of power units, you know, full of these immortals and void rays and whatever else. Monty, though, you can see that economic leader has definitely started pulling back into this. From moments ago where he's 30, 40 army supply down, he's now in an army lead. As we see the plus one advantage as well, now turning into plus two advantage. It's going to be interesting. So it's kind of intriguing. Again, I feel as though Verdi's army is just that much better. It is that much better, but Monty's army is starting to get larger, and it's starting to be better, you know, got better upgrades on it. Now, we are going to see Verdi attempting to go into carriers here, which is a very, very interesting way to try and transition. It's going to leave him very vulnerable here for a few minutes where he's building up into this composition. But if he gets to it, then Monty is going to be in a world of trouble, because how do you ever build, you know, how do you ever take down carriers which you never scouted coming, which you never really prepared for yourself? Well, you kind of just don't. It's very, very difficult to do that. As the Sorgas continue to move around, continue to look to see what they might be able to get up to over here, and just, you know, slowly trying to lay a fourth base more than anything, because that's what they can do. I mean, they can't really do anything when his opponent just sets on the three bases, but he can definitely try and slow down a fourth but just by having some presence out here. But even that, I mean, if this army moves down this ramp, the only thing that's stopping Verdi moving down this ramp is the fact that he's committing into carriers, and so he doesn't have as large an army as he usually would at this point. If he had just continued to build kind of immortals and archons, gateway based units, and moved down here, then it'd be even easier for him to take a fourth base, because, you know, by sitting down here on Dust Towers, you naturally defend your main and your third base from attacks on the ground. Obviously, he's then got the Phoenix out and about, and Void Rays too, to kind of hunt down war prisoners if he needs to protect the other entrances to his four bases. Monty maxes out, he's going to begin moving across the map, and, well, does he attack up into this? What does he do? I mean, the first carriers are now out. You can see Monty's taking a huge supply lead in the recent few moments of the game, but again, what does that really, you know, how much does that really matter? You know, how much does that really matter when we're talking about carriers now being on the map? Carriers are very, very good unit. They can actually be very, very effective at cleaning up. You know, when you get a few of them out, if you survive the transition to carriers, they can be very good. Generally, the main problem with carriers is the fact that it just takes so long to get, you know, to get to the stage where you can get to carriers safely. But Verdi has managed it in this game. Okay, albeit he has sacrificed the timing of his fourth base for a while, but he sacrificed that kind of, blanket in economy, that safety net in his economy of a fourth base. He sacrificed that to just go for a super strong, super late game composition. So he can afford to kind of take the fourth base a little bit later on, as you see War Prism going to come around all the way along the top side of the map and down the left-hand side, looking to hopefully try and get in towards the natural again and maybe get some further damage done over there. This time the R2 cannon is ready. Monty is also 200 over 200, so even though you could warp in kind of 12 zealots at a time with 12 warp gates, and with the bank he has, he's not going to be able to because he's supply blocked currently. So he's going to have to trade away some supply if he wants to make this War Prism useful at all in the near future. War Prism continue to move along this left-hand side then, as actually we see some Stalkers coming in from Monty. Going to start training against some Depths of Verdi again. Plus two weapons on the ground for Monty here, as he does now for the first time start to see the army composition of his opponent again. He's not seen this for a very long time. And he is wondering what's going on. You know, he's been wondering, you know, what's happening. He's even got a Stalker down at this goal base just in case that's being taken. Monty warps in a bunch more DTs, warps in a bunch more Archons with them to continue looking to maybe push forwards here. Does he have enough to go up against what is now 7 carriers, 5 warriors, and 6 immortals in this army of Verdi? I'm not too sure, but I guess we're about to find out. Lots of cannons coming down. They'll die very quickly, but they will slow down some of these zealots here initially. As you start to see this army coming forward, the zealots are going to start siphoning through the Archons. As we're going to see the Archons just actually fighting against the Interceptors. And, well, so far it looks like Monty is starting to push this back. It's starting to take this position down the low ground, will stop this fourth base from being established. Now just back away, 3 more carriers on the way up, more interceptors being rebuilt. After that didn't go so well with Verdi, and after seeing that fight, I begin to wonder I mean, okay, he's getting more carriers, but nothing seemed to die in that engagement for Monty. It looked as though he had a very easy time pushing on through and just looking to kind of get into a pretty good side. I'm not sure how this is going to go. I mean, Monty now taking the fifth base as well. And we see very still stuck on three bases. You know, I thought, you know, carriers very good, but are they enough in this game? He's getting to this point where it really is just mass carrier. These Immortals on the ground still going to be very useful. Other than that, he only has one Adept, one Stalker, and even the four Phoenix getting to the point where he maybe even just wants to trade these off. He's just killed 14 workers, though. These Phoenix had so much energy on them. So 14 workers going down. Warpism is actually going to be just continue to patrol the top side of the map, I guess. Just kind of keeping itself busy. As actually, we do see an engagement starting to come in down to the south side. Monty going to take this fight once again as you see him caught up trying to fight against these Interceptors. Void Rays prop their prismatic alignments. A lot of the Interceptors are going down. You see it blinks forwards as he will start to see the carriers, voids, and more starting to fall in this position. However, Monty looks as though he's starting to run low. However, the Interceptors are also starting to run low as well in these carriers. And without Interceptors, obviously the carriers don't actually ever really kill anything. But it looks as though there's just about enough. And Verdi is going to be able to push this back in this army. And it's going to win out here for Verdi as he picks off another Immortal, another Stalker as they back away. The last couple of Interceptors are going to come back to the carriers now. We're going to see more and more carriers, Interceptors being rebuilt here. Nice lifts on these Phoenix to trap these units in position, stop them from escaping. Because again, them Interceptors doing so much here. The Phoenix, man, continuing to just do so much in this. One more Archon's added for Monty. He will once again be looking to just try and trade here. But the carriers, well, they're ready to go once again. They've got all their Interceptors back and ready. There's still a few Void Rays left in this too. And this airplay from Verdi might just be the winning move for him in this game. It looked as though it wasn't maybe going to be super effective, but it looks as though in the end, a few extra carriers, it was just what he needed. And he just, you know, we just can't see, you know, Monty just wasn't able to get rid of the carriers in time. You can see him pulling probes into this now as well, but that's not going to help. There's nothing to actually fight on the ground. Maybe just let the Interceptors waste their time on a couple of things, but Monty going to lose pretty much everything. GG called, and one of the closer games of the series, but it still goes the way of Verdi, and it confirms his second